Coming up on this episode of Disneyland Weekly, Mickey Mouse is turning 90, construction on the new parking structure has begun,
a new way to experience the resort, and we continue our tour of California Adventure and more. Disneyland Weekly starts now.
This is Disneyland Weekly.
Hello and welcome to this episode of Disneyland Weekly for the week of March 7th, 2018. I'm Tag Bushman.
And I'm Teresa Urban. Thank you for joining us this week. Now, let's get to the news. The Walt Disney Company is honoring Mickey Mouse all through 2018 for his 90th birthday. Mickey debuted on November 18, 1928 in the animated short Steamboat Willie. There are plenty of events including The Happiest Show on Earth, a runway fashion show, Mickey, the True Original, a celebration of Mickey's heritage, ABC and Disney Channel will air specials, Disney on Ice will have a special Mickey pre-show, as well as a new production and more.
In the parks, Mickey's birthday will be celebrated on November 18th with commemorative merchandise, photo locations, and more. In late 2018, Disney parks all over the world will host the world's biggest mouse party, a salute to Mickey and Minnie. D23 will be partnering with the Disney Archives to paint Mickey's official birthday portrait that will be on the cover of the fall D23 magazine. Does any of this sound interesting to you?
Yes, I really now think that November is when I need to be in the parks.
You just always think you have to be in the parks.
It's true. It's true. I just need to move. I just need to move to Anaheim.
You know, if they're doing this much stuff for his 90th birthday, I wonder how much stuff they're going to have for his 100th birthday.
Oh my gosh. Yeah, you're right. It has begun. Work on the new parking structure has started with the removal of the old surface lot next to Mickey and Friends. This has resulted in the tram and security area being moved into the old structure. This has also made walking over to Downtown Disney or the parks very challenging. If you'd like to see some photos of this, laughingplace.com has a lot of pictures.
Yeah, it's nice to actually see
Some progress.
Progress being made on the new parking garage because, you know, we went from the Eastern Gateway project now to this, and it's desperately needed. I mean, it always seems a lot further away than it is, but Galaxy's Edge is only, you know, a year and a half maybe away. I mean, they got a lot of work to do. Well, starting on March 16th, you can once again participate in the Egg Stravaganza in Disney California Adventure through April 1st. You can pick up a map for $5.99 and search for hidden eggs themed to Disney characters around the park. There's also a special surprise when you turn in your map at Elias & Company, Disney Showcase, or the World of Disney Store. I know we were talking before the podcast that you were excited by this.
Yes. I mean, anything that's extra in the park sounds fun and, you know, fascinating to me, I guess. So, I've never done this egg extravaganza thing. Have you?
No. Well, I think the last time I was there, they had some type of scavenger hunt going on in the park, and I didn't do it.
I'd be all over this.
Yeah. I think for Disneyland, for locals and for the kids especially, I think it's going to be great. Usually we've discussed this before. When you and I are there, we've got time constraints. And all that.
That's true. But this sounds like a lot of fun. So if any of our listeners do end up going and participating in the egg extravaganza, please let us know what you thought of it and how you liked it and what you found. And I'm curious what this special surprise is at the end of it, too.
So me too.
Let us know what you find out. If you are an annual pass holder, you can now get a special 8P logo embroidered onto your hat or other embroidable items. This new service is available anywhere hats or embroidered items are sold throughout the parks.
Yeah, this kind of looks interesting. You get the signature Disney AP logo. You can get it on anything. In the pictures that the Disney Parks blog posted, it looked like you can get it on, obviously, like your Mickey hats. It looked like they had like a towel or a washcloth or something you could get it on, you know, for like their kitchen stuff. It looked like there was a dress you could get it embroidered on. Honestly, since the last time I was at the parks, I feel like they've added a lot of things you can embroider stuff onto. So I'm surprised. And kind of happy it's not just like the, because it used to just be like the Mickey hats. So it's cool that they have that on other things.
And, you know, it's kind of a neat logo. The P, I don't know if everyone has seen what this logo looks like. The P, instead of having a traditional P, it has a little Mickey silhouette for the opening of the P. So it's kind of a cute, but a very, like, kind of a simplistic logo. I really like it.
Well, here's
honestly,
the question.
This is ridiculous. I'm looking at this and I want to become an annual pass holder just so I can have this embroidered somewhere, because they're really tastefully done, looking at the different images that have come, you know, that have come up with it.
Now, the question is, do these count as a hidden Mickey?
Everything's a hidden Mickey. Of course it's a hidden Mickey, but I don't think it counts because you're wearing it.
So I don't want to.
I feel like hidden Mickeys are like physical parts of the park.
I suppose. I don't want to get too far off track, but I'm so good at it, you know? So I took that walk in Walt's Footstep store that we talked about before. So it was funny because our tour guide, we were in New Orleans Square, and in the Crystal Shop, I think, there in New Orleans Square, he said, you know, there's tons of hidden Mickeys all over the park, but here there's a hidden Walt. And there was like a Walt Disney face made out of like crystal or something like up on the wall.
Oh, strange.
Yeah. Unable to go to the parks as often as you like?
Yes.
Feeling withdrawal?
Of course.
No fear. Google has come to the rescue. Beginning this week, you can now see the parks on Google Street View. There are a series of 360-degree panoramas of Disneyland and Walt Disney World. I'm so excited to be able to see the parks whenever I want now. They just need to add the attractions. Don't you think?
You know, we were playing around with this before the podcast. They're really well done, and really, it does like take you back and make you feel like you're actually in the park. They're really well done. I'm really excited to continue to kind of like, I don't know, explore and search through them. Just really cool. I'm surprised they were allowed to go in and do this. I'm surprised Disney let them.
Disney loves it.
I think it's really cool. And if you go online, we were looking at disneyparks.com is where we were kind of getting this information from. They actually have photos of, because I'm like, I said to Tag, I said, how do they even get these photos? Because I've seen the Google car going past, you know, down the street or whatever, and their funny little camera apparatus that's on top. I'm like, well, obviously they didn't take the car in there, but they have these sort of like backpacks that have the big camera on top of it. So they just trotted around, hiked around the parks and got all the cool different shots of everything. So it's really neat. Highly, highly, highly recommend that you check it out.
Well, I don't know about you, Teresa, but I can get lost for hours on Google Street View anyway and Google Maps, because I love looking at satellite views of things. Mm-hmm. So now I feel like I'm going to waste a whole bunch more hours looking at Disney parks.
I'm sure you will.
They just needed the other ones now, like Shanghai. Like, I'd love to see Shanghai.
That's what I was thinking too when we were first looking through this. I'm like, oh, do they have like Disneyland, you know, the parks I haven't been to? That'd be really cool to, you know, virtually walk around. They don't yet. I don't know if they ever will, but I think they should.
I think they should too.
Some other news bits from around the resort include some new information on some shows and attractions. Paint the Night is currently scheduled for two nightly performances starting on April 13th at 8:45 and 10:45. World of Color is going down for refurbishment on April 13th with no announced return date. Splash Mountain is set to reopen on Saturday, April 14th.
Yeah, it sounds like World of Color is going to get some much-needed refurbishment and break during the Pixar Fest festivities that are starting with Paint the Night and everything happening over there. Well, Paint the Night, you know, is going to be in California Adventure, so you do have some type of nighttime spectacular. Mm-hmm. Splash Mountain reopening. I'm really excited to see if they fix all the problems we've talked about before.
I hope so. They had to have, right? I mean,
yeah. On my stage, there were some pictures of the flume that had been replaced. It looks great. So I am very optimistic. Well, as we've been doing for weeks now on this podcast, we have been taking a tour of Disneyland, and the last couple of weeks we have been at Disney California Adventure. This week, we have entered Buena Vista Street, we have gone through Hollywoodland, and now we are entering A Bug's Land. And then after that, we're going to do Cars Land as well, because there's not much to talk about Bug's Land. So, Teresa, you have done a ton of research. And so tell us about, well, do you have anything just about the land in general.
Yes. So the land in general opened on October 7th, 2002. And I guess I didn't realize that there's actually a backstory to the land. So the kind of fictional story behind it was that Flick and his other bug friends kind of were inspired and when they saw Disney California Adventure. And so they decided to open and build their own fun fair. And so when the Imagineers started to build the Tower of Terror, which is right next to them, they discovered the bugs, discovered their fun fair. And then everybody decided to open up Flick's fun fair to the park guests as well. So I thought that was kind of a neat little backstory to the land. I don't really think any of the other lands have a little funny, I don't know,
backstory,
but I like it a lot. I think it works well, and it kind of explains why, because I mean a lot of the attractions in here are just kind of, I don't know, they're kind of random. You kind of feel like you've been shrunk down to a bug, but it's not like it's anything specifically from the movie. It's the characters from the movie, but
What really kind of sparked the creation of this land at California Adventure was the fact that when California Adventure opened in early 2001, they had low attendance, which was mostly because there was lack of rides appropriate for young children and not a lot of e-ticket attractions. So that's why Tower of Terror was being built. And if you go over, you know, if you're in the original California Adventure, you've got California Screamin', you got the Maliboomer, you got a lot of these kind of thrill rides that little kids are not going to do.
Right.
So there really wasn't anything for kids. So now they thought, okay, well, let's do this. A lot of the attractions we're going to talk about very quickly in this land, because there really isn't, these are all kind of off the shelf, like carnival almost rides, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. And it was really just because they needed to do something quickly. I mean, California Adventure opened in February of 2001. This opened October of 2002. So this was like the first big expansion for it. And, you know, there's rumors that it may be going away or getting shrunk down or something to be, you know, integrated into Marvel Land and stuff, which I think would be okay, because a lot of the reason for this land coming into existence doesn't...
It was kind of just a filler, really.
Yep. It's nice. So I do... one of the things I remember always wanting to go do at Disney World in their Hollywood Studios, which at the time was MGM Studios, was they had a Honey, I Shrunk the Kids area that, like, you were shrunk down.
You know, yep, and I did visit that. I have memories of doing that when I was just a wee one. That was actually my first ever trip to a Disney park, was to Walt Disney World with my family. And I remember hanging out in the Honey, I Shrunk the Kids little play area while my parents were at, I was left with other adults that were in our party, but my parents went on the Tower of Terror. And so,
you mean they didn't just abandon you?
No, they didn't. Myself, my brother, and the other family's children that we were with all got to play in the land while I believe it was the mother stayed with us and the rest of the adults went on.
So that was something that I was excited about.
It was really cool.
With A Bug's Land, was having to experience that again, because a lot of the canopy there are giant clovers.
Yeah, and it does make you kind of feel like you were shrunk down to the size of the bug. Plus, I like the little water park thing that they have.
Yeah,
I think
the
that's always
pad.
Fun for and kids always have a great time with that.
Well, you know what? I actually thought the theming of this land was pretty cool, because like the bathrooms are themed to like a tissue box or something. The entrance to the park, if you're coming from not the side with Guardians of the Galaxy, but if you're coming from the main pathway where the parade route goes, you actually go through like a I believe it's like a cereal box. I think you enter through. And the land is lit by like Christmas, you know, big oversized Christmas lights or lighting
really
like
cool.
that.
It's really cool. And that just, I think that kind of, that's going to segue into the first attraction, which is Flick's Flyers, which Flick's Flyers is a spinner ride, but same concept. If you kind of really look at the attraction itself, it appears like it's been fashioned out of old used food containers, and everything looks like it's been stitched together with either leaves or twigs. And they made these kind of makeshift balloons out of discarded things too, and everything rolls around a pie plate, I believe it is. So, you know, you kind of feel like, you know, the bugs actually built everything. So it's, the theming in this area is really, really neat.
Yeah, it reminds me of stuff. I mean, I have some fond memories. Like, I don't know if you ever watched, did you ever watch Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers?
Oh gosh, yes.
I was obsessed with Gadget's, I can't remember what it's called now, but the plane that they were in that was made out of a bleach bottle, like a balloon. And I remember wanting to like, build one of these as a kid. And so being able to go into a land like a Bugs Land here and seeing this stuff that actually has been fashioned to look like this stuff is kind of, you know, it's kind of my little kid dream come true.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's definitely, it's great. They definitely hit it out of the park for kids, for sure.
For sure. Yep.
So what's next?
So moving on, we're going to go to Heimlich's Choo Choo Train.
Oh, I love this attraction. Heimlich. Yeah.
So Heimlich, for those of you that don't know, is the
he's a caterpillar. He's wants to be a caterpillar.
Yes, he is the German accented caterpillar who wants to, doesn't he really wants to be a butterfly. Anyway, so his favorite activity, like many of us, is eating. And so the choo-choo train, you actually kind of go along with him through basically these just kind of giant oversized portions of human food. And it looks and it appears that Heimlich has been eating his way through all of these foods. Now, I guess I never realized this, but the giant food sets in this attraction actually have the different fragrances that accompany it. So as you're going through the giant watermelon, they're spraying the watermelon fragrance at you. So it
they spray
nice
it at you because it's also a juicy watermelon. So you get dripped on and it smells like watermelon. Then you go through the box of animal crackers and it smells like animal crackers. I have to say, in all of California Adventure, this is kind of my guilty pleasure attraction. I love Heimlich's voice. I love some of the stupid humor they have in this attraction. Yeah. One of my favorite lines from the attraction is, "They say carrots are good for my eyes, but I don't want to put carrots in my eyes."
Oh, Heimlich.
I loved it. And he loves candy corn. You didn't get me singing this week so far, but you got me trying to do a really bad German accent.
Doing voice impressions here.
It is a pretty terrible attraction. It goes very slow. It's meant for
it's a kid's attraction.
I know, but you know what? I really like it. You know, sometimes we get some feedback that, like, you know, we're adults and we're talking from an adult perspective. But you know what?
There's a kid inside, and there's a kid inside all of us, right?
Yes.
All right, so moving on. Francis Ladybug Boogie. I've actually never been on this one, but this is a spinning attraction that you...
Hold up, you went on Heimlich. You haven't been on Heimlich either?
I have not been on Heimlich.
If it's still there when we go, I'm making you go on it.
You know, I haven't done any of the... I have not rode on any of the attractions in A Bug's Land. Anyway.
Continue.
So the ride spins guests around... kind of like Mad Tea Party, the teacups, but not really. Same, similar, but features some jazz music. Guests are spun around as they're boogieing. The bugs are boogieing to the music. So, again, another ride that's really good for children.
I've never
been
on this one.
Maybe not so much for adults, but great for children. And then we've already talked about Princess Dot's Puddle Park. So that's the little, I guess, kind of splash pad area. It has all these cool fountains. I always see kids running through them and having a great time. And it's great, especially in hot California weather. Perfect.
I love the fact that part of this looks like a sprinkler head from like a hose.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Again, it makes you feel like you're a bug among all of the oversized garden tools, because there are tools and stuff in this area too. So it makes you feel like you're a bug still. And there's also the tuck and roll drive 'em buggies. And this is kind of like bumper cars. So tuck and roll are the pill bugs that are kind of the, I guess they're like the acrobats of the circus show from the A Bug's Life movie.
I'm with you. I have not been on Francis's Ladybug Boogie or Tuck and Roll's drive 'em buggies. I did go on Flix Flyers, and I have obviously been on Heimlich numerous times. But there's one more attraction that actually is kind of a little bit out of A Bug's Land.
Yeah, so it's a Tough to Be a Bug, which is, I don't know, it's neat. I don't know if you've ever experienced a tag or, you know, if anybody that's listening has done it. But it's really, you know, the first time I heard about it, I'm like, maybe I could skip it. I don't know. But I did attend it with children, and it's really well done. The animatronics in this are just
the Hopper animatronic is
amazing, just really, really cool. So It's Tough to Be a Bug actually predates A Bug's Land. It opened back on February 8th of 2001
with
the California Adventure park itself. This attraction is located in California Adventure, but also it's in the Animal Kingdom. This was an original attraction to Disney California Adventure, the park. And one thing that I thought was really cool when we were listening to it beforehand is if you listen carefully to the cue music, it is actually parodies of different famous Broadway shows. And so it's the sound of the different songs that you know, but it's, I guess sung made by bugs, maybe.
Bug sounds.
It's kind of, yeah, it's made out of bug sounds. So some examples were Beauty and the Bees, so its tale as old as time, as buzzed by bees. Mm-hmm. Hello, Dung Lover, so that's just a just a parody in and of itself. And then they also have a version of Tonight, which is mixed with The Flight of the Bumblebee. So very well done, very creative. Highly would recommend going on this.
Now, I will say, the things that I remember most about It's Tough to Be a Bug is the Hopper animatronic is great. Oh. The special effects in the auditorium, they have smoke and everything, mm-hmm. really cool. The one thing I absolutely do not like about this attraction is there's a part where the bugs are rolling along and it always hits my spinal cord and it hurts because it's like they're supposed to be like rolling behind you, like on the chair. And it's a neat effect, but it's just too hard. And now they've been using this theater for movie premiere-y kind of stuff, like the Sunset Showcase Theater. So if you are there, you may or may not get to experience it.
The other thing too, just as a warning to those of you with parents, is this is kind of, some kids do get a little scared by this because there is a few scenes in here that
there's spiders that come from the ceiling.
There's, you know, kind of like, I don't know, I guess mad, angry bugs that are kind of, kind of coming at you. The Hopper animatronic is mad and kind of yelling. So it is a little, you know, can be a little much, a little intimidating for kids, but it is really neat.
Well, going from the first expansion of Disney California Adventure in A Bug's Land to the latest, biggest expansion is Cars Land. What do you have about the land in general?
Cars Land just recently opened up. June 15th, 2012 was its official opening date. It is built on 12 acres, and it was part of Disney California Adventure's big expansion project. That entire expansion project was actually $1.1 billion expansion for California Adventure, which it needed, so I'm glad that they did.
Well, and they used the money well. I mean, that land is gorgeous.
Yes, yes. So the concept art for Cars Land actually first surfaced back in 2006 in the Dreaming section of the Walt Disney Company's 2006 annual report. So I guess I didn't realize that we were talking about it that much before it had opened. So that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
And they were actually, you know, it first came into thought not long after the movie Cars had been released.
It says 6 months here. Yep. I will say there's a couple tidbits that I have that I remember hearing about with Cars Land. So one of the things I'd like to say, first of all, is I was excited when this attraction, when Radio Space Racers, which is the flagship attraction for this land, was announced because it is built on the test track ride system. And I had not been to Disney World before Cars Land opened. And I always wanted to go on that type of an attraction. And I was elated that it was coming with Cars Land. The other thing there was rumors about for a long time, and again, I'm not really sure if this was true, but it was a lot of rumors that when they were originally trying to construct the land, that the Cadillac range that are all Cadillac fins, Cadillac was not going to allow them to use that because
I hadn't heard that rumor.
Yeah, and so I remember when they, before construction began and people were, like it had been confirmed that they were going to build it, that people were saying that Cadillac, that Disney and Cadillac were kind of having some issues because they wanted to be able to use the fins on the mountain range and they weren't sure about it. Another piece of information that comes with the mountain range that was built here is that there was some people that were unhappy when this land was first constructed because if you are inside Cars Land, it's beautiful. It's great. You feel like you are in Radiator Springs. But if you're driving down Catella, they didn't finish the backside of any of these.
Oh.
So it was really ugly to begin with. And I think they've done some placemaking behind it, some cosmetic
things.
Yes. So I think people are a little happier now, but in the beginning it was just like this giant ugly wall that was blocking off everything. So, but you know, I still think it looks better than the parking lot that was there before, which was the last remnants of the Disneyland original parking structure or parking lot. So we started talking about the main attraction, which is Radiator Springs Racers. What do you have about that, Tree?
All right, so this did open up with the land on June 15th, 2012. So as Tag already mentioned, it does feature a version of the technology that was originally developed for the Test Track attraction in Epcot. I haven't had a chance to. I've been on Radiator Springs Racer. I have not done the Test Track.
Really?
So I'd be interested to know, you know, like somebody's comparison or their notes to compare the two to see, you know, how different it is. Because, like I said, it's based on it. So I'm wondering if it's the same or if it's different, you know, if there's things that are better.
I've been on both.
Okay.
Yeah, so I've been on both. I feel like, and it may be true or not, but I feel like the version at Epcot with Test Track, I feel like you go faster.
Okay.
But it may not be true because there's really nothing to look at Epcot. You just go out and you kind of circle around. Radio Springs Roosters, you go out and you're flying, but you're going up and down, and it's more contained. So there's definitely, I think the theming overall is better at Radiator Springs Racers than at Test Track. Not to say Test Track isn't a great attraction. It is.
So I just looked it up. So sure. before the podcast, I was looking at the Radiator Springs stuff. So I can tell you that the Radiator Springs ride vehicles can reach a top speed of 40 miles an hour. Just doing a quick search here, it looks like the Test Track actually can reach up to 65 miles an hour. So
it does go faster.
It does go faster.
Gotcha. All right. What else?
So this is interesting. This is the most expensive attraction at the Disneyland Resort. It cost them over $200 million to build just this attraction.
Well, I think a lot of it was with the mountain range too, probably.
No, well, yeah. So it said this single attraction of that $1.1 billion budget that we had talked about before, 11% of it, I believe it was, went into just this attraction. And remember that $1.1 billion expansion, that was Cars Land, yes, but it was also the redoing of Buena Vista Street. It was just various things throughout the entire park.
Yep.
So they put a lot of money into this one attraction. And I think that they did I think that was a smart move because this is super popular. Every time I'm there, there's a nice
long
line.
There's always a wait. Yep.
Even when you do the Fast Pass, there's still a wait.
Yeah, but that's what I found too. It was one of the first attractions that even the Fast Pass line felt long.
Yeah. All right, and then the last thing that I had too was, so, you know, for those of you that haven't been on this attraction, you do have a section of it that you're actually racing another car, and I just thought it was interesting. I guess I should have realized this, but the winning car of the race is always selected at random, so it's not some sort of program that every fifth car is the left car that wins, or, you know,
it's completely
random, so you never know if you're going to win or not.
That's nice. Yeah, I remember going on this attraction. There's a couple really wow moments for me on Radiator Springs Racers. The first wow moment is, you leave the station, you're kind of outside, you're going kind of slow, and then there's this part where you kind of go under this rock, and you come out, and you can't see it beforehand, but the music, you know, crescendos and everything, and there's this waterfall that you see, and it comes out with the music, and I remember thinking, that is so cool. That was such an awesome, like, with the music and the visuals, it just all went together well. And then the indoor portion of the attraction is awesome too. I mean, because you go in and you see a lot of the characters from the movie.
Yeah, and again, the animatronics in this are just amazing.
They look like talking cars.
They're very smooth. You feel like you just, like, stepped right into the film.
Absolutely. And I enjoy it. The last time I was there, I was a little let down because there's a section where you go in and your car is supposed to be painted. And then, what's his name? What's the, I'm looking here. They got a whole list of people, but I don't see him. Well, the sheriff, the guy who played the sheriff car.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't working. He was just sitting there and he was supposed to, like, talk to you. And I was like, oh no, he's not working. But otherwise, I really enjoy the attraction. I wasn't a huge fan of the Cars movie in general, but I like this land a lot. So what's next?
So moving along, we've got the Mater's Junkyard Jamboree. I've never done this one. This is definitely themed towards smaller children, which I think is perfect because you do need that. You know, this is it. You know, this is a land that's really supposed to be a park that's really supposed to be geared towards children.
Yeah.
It's not all about us adults today.
It's true.
But anyway, so I have not gone on this attraction, but it looks fun. The music that's always playing with this is really fun and catchy. And
agreed.
I mean, who doesn't love Mater?
Of course.
He's such a lovable character.
He is a lovable character.
But this attraction also did open with Cars Land back June 15th of 2012.
So there is going to be a version of this ride system that will be used in the new Toy Story Land in Disney World. I know that's been a big deal for Disney World. I did ride this attraction when I took my friend Jay a few years ago.
Sure.
And all I remember is it was hilarious. So we were on the attraction. I had my camera with me, and I'm trying to record us on the attraction because I thought it was funny, right? So we're on this attraction, and I get to the end. And I don't have my lens cap.
Oh, no.
And I don't know where my... And so my lens cap had this, like, rubber band thing that would, like, hold it to the camera. And I don't know where it went. So I watched the video back, and there was a certain part I got flung around, and you could just see it go snapping off of the lens and flying off. So luckily somebody was able to find it and give it back to me.
I was going to say, did you get it?
No, it was... Yeah, but it was just hilarious, because I'll see if I can find that video, and maybe I'll post it on the Patreon page. Because it's like, you're just going, and all of a sudden, it's like, there goes this lens cap, and I didn't notice it at the time. It was fun. It's like those... I like riding when you go to the fair, and they have I don't remember what the attraction's called, but basically, like, it's three kind of spinning like arms, and like as you go, it like flings you to the outside. That's kind of like what Mater's like. I don't know. I really liked it. So
the neat thing too with Mater's Junkyard Jamboree is they actually have two different holiday themings for this. They have Mater's Graveyard Jamboree that we talked about during Halloween. And then I don't think we mentioned this, but they did have Mater's Jingle Jamboree during the Christmas season.
I think we might have grazed over it really quickly. We didn't talk in depth about it at all. Like the fact that they theme them, makes them different.
Mm-hmm. So the last attraction in Cars Land is Luigi's Rollickin' Roadsters.
Rollickin'.
I think I said that. Rollickin' Roadsters. So again, this one did too have a Halloween overlay and also a Christmas overlay. So for Halloween, it was Luigi's Honking Halloween and Luigi's Joy to the World during Christmas. They're just so clever with these names. I just love it. So this actually was just most recently open. It was open March 7th, 2016. It did replace Luigi's Flying Tires, which was original to the land. I have not been on the Rollickin' Roadsters. I did have a chance to go on the Flying Tires attraction. I kind of understand why they got rid of that one. That one was interesting. You kind of were on this, I don't know, it was like a cement pad, and they had all of these fans basically blowing up at you, and you actually kind of floated along in your tire, and the vehicles got stuck a lot. So I can see how they had to, you know, do something different with this area.
Are you aware at all of the history of that ride system?
The original flying ride tires. System? No. Mm-mm.
So John Lasseter from Pixar wanted to bring back one of the most famous old, not around anymore attractions from Tomorrowland. And where Space Mountain is today, there was an attraction that was called the Flying Saucers, and it used a ride system very similar to this. And there's a lot of video and stuff online from people in the 60s when this was an attraction, but it kept having problems, so eventually they ended up getting rid of it. So they wanted to bring it back for Luigi's Flying Tires, because they're like, this is a cool system, we have all this technology now, let's make it work. Mm-hmm. And so they did Luigi's Flying Tires. They had some problems with the new ride vehicles because of all the safety and everything, and I hate to say it, but Americans are chunkier now than they were. Made it so like they didn't want the tires would not move very well. Mm-hmm. And the control was hard because you had to like lean towards where you want to go. But if you're like a small kid, you can't get enough of your body weight to like move to go somewhere. Mm-hmm. So they thought, okay, it's moving slow. For a while, they added beach balls in there, and that became a problem as well. And people were getting hit with them, and it was just weird, and it took forever. It took longer. You spent more time loading and unloading than you did actually on the attraction.
Sure.
So the Rollickin' Roadsters, I've seen videos from it. I'll tell you what, I love some of the music for this attraction.
Mm-hmm.
I like the little cars. Again, I think that it's less of an adult thing. It's definitely more aimed at kids, which is great. Yeah. I am excited to ride it. For the first time when we get back.
So I thought it was interesting. The ride vehicles for the Rollickin' Road Coasters are actually supposedly all of Luigi's cousins who have come to visit Radiator Springs, and they are having a dance celebration. So that's the little story behind that. So I thought that was cute.
Yeah, they've done a great job with story in these lands, mm-hmm. for sure.
Oh, yes. Yep.
And of course, you know, that's pretty much all the attractions we have for Cars Land, but I would also be amiss if I did not talk about some of the restaurants they have here, because they did a great job theming the restaurants. So first of all, they have the Cozy Cone Motel, which has a bunch of different like snack stuff mm-hmm. that you can get. I think they have like different popcorns and stuff you can get there. They have great like slushy kind of drinks. So they have some stuff that's kind of like the frozen version of like butterbeer.
Oh, okay.
That's pretty good. And they have some good, you know, just like different flavors of popcorn and stuff. And
yeah, yeah, I feel treats. Like the Cozy Cone has just a lot of kind of, I don't know, more like snack type
yeah,
foods.
Yeah, exactly. And they're good and they're mm-hmm. different. You mm-hmm. can't really get them anywhere else.
I think there's like some funky corn dog thing maybe yep. too. Yeah.
I agree. Yep. Mm-hmm. And then Flo's V8 Cafe is the huge kind of sit down eatery kind of place, kind of grab and go. I ate there once. And I thought it was okay. Like, mm-hmm. I can't, like, it wasn't my, like, oh, I got to come back to this.
Sure.
The inside area does look out onto Radiator Springs Racers, which is really nice.
Oh.
So that's kind of nice. I actually never ate at Fillmore's Taste, and I think that's like a grab-and-go kind of, like, snack cart. And then there's also three different shopping places there. There's the Ramon's House of Body Art, Sarge's Surplus Hut, which I just think is a cool design for a shop. It looks mm-hmm. like a hut. And then the Curios, which is just kind of a big shopping area there. So overall, I think it's a great land. They do an excellent job decorating it for Christmas. Mm-hmm. They actually add a whole other set of telephone poles down the main drag. And they have you know, the garland and stuff. And it's all themed to look like the Cars decorated
yeah,
it.
Yeah, what they're doing with this land is just so, so amazing. And it gives me so much hope of things that maybe are coming for the future. So I like it. The other thing that I do need to mention, too, before we
yeah.
wrap up is you need to visit this land at night because they
oh,
have
yes.
it lit up beautifully. If anyone's ever seen the movie, it looks exactly like this, you know, how they light it up for that one night that they're doing the cruise night.
Yep.
So they have all the neon lit and everything. It looks awesome.
I would say it looks better at night, but I also think all of Disneyland looks better at night. Yeah.
It just has a different charm to it at night is all.
I'll tell you what though, this land is definitely, I think it's 110% Disney magic.
Yes, for sure.
Like, it does not feel like they cut corners anywhere.
No, not at all.
It's, I could see Walt Disney himself having built this land, like mm-hmm. coming straight out of his thing. So
it's amazing because both of these lands, both the Bugs Land and Cars Land, just really make you feel as if you are in a completely different world, like you've stepped into the lives of these characters, and it's just so well done.
Agreed. Totally agree. Well, let's move on to some feedback. So we're going to kind of try to do feedback slightly differently. We're going to talk about some Patreon feedback. If we have any iTunes reviews or anything or email, we're going to put that in here too. We just don't have any this week. So, but from Patreon, Laura said in referring to our last episode about the smells in Monsters, Inc. And about the Tower of Terror changing to Guardians, she said, the smells are working when I was there last. I'm still mad about Tower of Terror changing to Guardians of the Galaxy Mission Breakout.
Yeah, and you know, I'm still on the fence about it too. I have not been a fan, but I've decided I just need to go experience it and then I can decide what I think. I do, you know, I think that it's really just kind of something that is kind of foreshadowing what's going to be changing and happening over in that area in the future. So that does make me excited.
Maybe we have to hold our judgment until the whole land is re-fanned.
Yes, that's true.
So first part of our Twitter feedback is from Disneyland Town, whose Twitter handle is @DisneylandTown. And we're going really Inception here. thanks to DL Weekly for the shout out on the podcast and posted a photo of excitement. So you're getting
welcome.
Another shout out. We will not continuously every week. Teresa laughed at me when I put this in the script for tonight. She goes,
we're gonna do a shout out to
for
because
a shout
of the
out.
thank you for the shout out.
Yeah, so
love it.
Yeah,
all right. So some feedback on Twitter from @TullerGuy79. I'm sorry if I butchered that. Shout out to our favorite podcast guy tag. Found his brick today. Love this podcast. So they did post a photo of them posing with Tag's brick. I'm just impressed at how many of you have actually gone out and figured out exactly where this brick was because y'all are better than me. I tried finding it before and I was apparently looking in the wrong area or something.
I am very, very excited that people are out doing this because my brick is probably lonely since I cannot visit it. So thank you for keeping my brick company.
All right. They also had to say that Mary Poppins was getting jolly today. Also linked a photo of...
Video.
Oh, yeah, that's right. It was a video. Mm-hmm. Linked a video of It's a Jolly Holiday little dance routine that they were doing in the street, which looked really fun.
Yes.
They also had a view of the construction by the Small World, also with a photo, which then had Rob Schweitzer at Rob Schweitzer replying, yay, trees, in response to the fact that it looks like they're going to have some more shaded areas in the queue for It's a Small World. So that, I'm excited about that too, because it's just kind of not very fun to stand in that queue area as it was before. So shade would be nice and helpful.
Of course. So thank you. By the way, the name is Jay Yates was the name on Twitter. So thank you, Jay Yates, for sending a video and for sending the picture
and photos,
of construction.
Yeah.
Yes. Anytime any of you are out in the parks and see anything interesting that you think might be newsworthy, send it along on Twitter or email it or Facebook or any of the ways.
Just send it to us.
Somehow get it to us. Jay Yates, you probably saw this week. As soon as I saw some of these things, I retweeted them to our followers.
Yeah.
You know, because we want to make sure that you guys get credit for sending us stuff. Plus, it's good to see you guys out and having fun at the parks, like we always tell you at the end of every podcast.
Exactly.
Our good friend Doug Stevenson at DougStevenson88 tweeted at us saying he could literally stand and watch inside this building for hours and not get bored. The art is so beautiful. This is in reference to our conversation last week about the Art of Animation building in Hollywood land. And so thanks, Doug, for sending that. And then Nick Christensen, again, at NCKCRSTNSN, said, thanks for the shout-out. Another great episode. By the way, I love the Animation Academy, and I think the whole building is highly underrated. So Doug and Nick, you guys should chat together
and go visit together.
I totally agree. And I kind of agree with you, Nick and Doug. I think it is highly underrated. Mm-hmm. It's great for air conditioning. I know that's not what you mean. But I think a lot of people overlook the uniqueness of this area.
I think, unfortunately, a lot of people are just in a hurry, so they just skip it because it's not an attraction, which, you know, is
sad. Are you
sad,
speaking
but,
from personal experience?
Well, yeah, and I've skipped it too for the same reason, but, you know, I think that's, I kind of in a weird sense think that's okay because of the people that truly love and appreciate it, then they kind of like still have it for themselves and you're not having to bust through a big crowd of people to what you need to do. So, you know, I think it would have a whole different feel if it was packed in there versus if you're able to kind of go through it at your own pace. Anyways, thank you again, Nick, for the feedback. Glad that you're enjoying the show. Love to have you as one of our listeners. So last but not least, Laura at Random Mexican says that she's still mad at that Frozen replaced Aladdin. I still and will always think Frozen is super overrated. Well, we kind of went through our opinions on
Frozen
versus Aladdin last episode. So it's good to know that other people are missing the Aladdin spectacular show too. It was really good and I just have to get over it. Again, I've decided I'm turning a new leaf. I'm not going to judge Frozen until I see it in person because I do think watching some of the things on different videos that we've seen online, there are some things that I think might have a little bit of a redeeming quality. Aladdin's always going to be number one though.
Well, the genie made Aladdin. We talked about this a lot last week. Well, as we wrap up,
thank you, Laura.
Yep. As we wrap up this week, we want to thank all of you for listening each and every week. Please don't forget to support the show if you can by going to DisneylandWeekly.com/support or sharing Disneyland Weekly on social media or by word of mouth with other Disneyland fans that you know.
We haven't seen any new reviews on iTunes recently, so please write a review so we can read it on the show and so that others can know what you think. If you want to join in the conversation, you can follow us on Facebook by searching for Disneyland Weekly, on Twitter at DL Weekly, or sending us an email at feedback@DisneylandWeekly.com. Please feel free to email, Facebook, or tweet at us any questions, feedback, suggestions, anything that you may have to say about the show.
Well, we'll be back next week with more Disneyland news and information.
So until then, go out and enjoy the parks.
Even digitally on Google Maps.
Ladies and gentlemen, Disneyland has now ended its normal operating day. We hope you've enjoyed your visit to the Magic Kingdom and that you'll be back with us again soon.